So, welcome. We had a little technical glitch tonight. Somehow Zoom required a password, which means that most of you are watching this on YouTube. Very sorry for that. We'll test my equipment more thoroughly next time. But nevertheless, we have an interesting topic tonight. Tonight with us is Stefan Opel, who joins us from Marburg tonight, who will tell us something about two very interesting topics in one package. Visualizing diagrams as code with AWS and doing so with Forge in Confluence and Jira, which is both very interesting. And with that, without further ado, over to you, Stefan, and your presentation. See you on the other side.
Thanks, Eric. I'll share my screen. Right, I hope this works. Thanks for having me and to this interesting talk. And also thanks to the sponsors who helped to run this user group. You have quite an impressive lineup there. I want to talk about, I also have technical difficulties here. That's the one thing. I want to talk about visualizing diagrams with AWS, but the key part is actually maintaining them as code and running this on the Atlassian Forge platform. I'm from Utility. We are a marketplace partner with Atlassian. We have a couple of apps. I will just briefly mention what we do. We basically focus on integrating Amazon Web Services with the Atlassian products. We currently have three apps in the marketplace. We have Identity Federation for AWS. That's a cross-product that's available for Jira, Confluence, Bitbucket, and Bamboo. And it basically is a single sign-on solution for AWS. And it provides the credentials so that you can interact with the actual services. Then we have automation with AWS. It's also supposed to be cross-product, but so far only available for Jira and Bamboo. And its goal is to extend workflows in your Atlassian products, like in Jira Services workflow or Jira Core workflow with actions in AWS. We are using the serverless platform as well, just like Atlassian with Forge, to achieve this. And finally, we have Tasks for AWS. That's actually our most successful app. It's for Bamboo only, and it helps you to provision infrastructure in AWS and to deploy software to AWS. Enough of that. What will I try to cover today? I want to give a brief overview about the Atlassian platform and the ecosystem evolution. Basically, what brought us here? Why do we have Forge now? Then I will, of course, cover the app that is the core of this talk. And afterwards, I would like to explore a bit the challenges and opportunities that the Forge platform represents for us as a marketplace partner in particular, but by extension for everyone who wants to use this. The Atlassian platform history, I wanted to go deeper there originally, but it's really just it gets too long, especially in light of recent events with the Atlassian server end of life announcement, where the user group here has a couple of upcoming presentations on talks, as I understand. So just very briefly, in the beginning, when we entered the marketplace, that was at around 2012, we had this Plugins 2 platform, what it's called. So it's a Java-based plugin framework where all the apps, all the code we as a vendor have written runs inside the Java virtual machine, inside the host product, so inside Jira, basically. This is very convenient. You can do all sorts of things. You have full access to all the whole product, but the downside is that you also have a couple of issues with security and the maintenance is very, 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 very classical. And of course, it doesn't run in the cloud, which is what everybody wants to do now. So Atlassian launched the Atlassian Cloud back then on demand in 2013, or actually 2011 already, but they needed a new solution to run apps because you couldn't use these plugins in the cloud, these old plugins to things. they had initially actually did that, but this didn't scale because effectively the vendor code ran inside the Atlassian software as a service offering, and that's really just nothing you want to do from an operations perspective, from the QSWIFT perspective, and so on. So what they build is the Connect framework, and that's an integration framework. So the apps run outside of the Atlassian tools and interact with them via REST APIs with webhooks. Those apps are easy to implement, but very hard to run. So you have a lot of security and operational challenges. We really want to do this as run this at scale. And that's what I call the challenge of the SaaS transformation that Atlassian and the ecosystem had to do from 2017 onwards, I would say. So Atlassian has grown a lot, as you know, has acquired a lot of users and is constantly evolving the products. However, this Connect framework is a bit of an afterthought, and Atlassian is not really using it themselves, actually. And so as they change things inside their products, if they want to do efficient and perform code, they can easily do that with their internal tools, but all the vendors or the whole ecosystem has to use this framework and all the problems that come with this. So, and to solve this, Atlassian has now embarked to the future Forge platform. And the idea here is that you get the code back into the platform itself. The code runs co-located with the help of AWS technology right beside the platform and is very performant and so on. We talk about this later. For us as a marketplace partner, this means that Atlassian has now upped the ante here, and it's now a requirement for partners who have a cloud app to actually qualify for higher tiers, like be a platinum partner or something. So we don't have cloud apps so far, and like just like everybody else, we want to go along with this, right? So we need to do this. And so nicely, Atlassian brought upon the CodeGeist again, the programming competition, and which was a really great opportunity for us to explore this platform with a new idea. So if you participate in such a programming competition, you of course need to think about what you want to do there. And so our first idea this year obviously was, can we do something which is related to remote work, maybe to help with the pandemic? And we actually did this. We developed an app that's called Meet with Jitsi. Jitsi is an open source video collaboration platform, and we made it easier to start a meeting right from Confluence and Jira. And we actually use this in production for our own needs, for our own team. But we, of course, also wanted to have some fun. And a longstanding fun topic for me has always been, I want to have these charts in my daily reports of our business processes. I want to have these handwritten charts in the XKCD style. And so we said, let's try this maybe. Let's try whether we can actually make this happen with the new possibilities of the Forge platform. I will now let you in into the trade secret of utility, our unique app strategy. And this is how it works. Of course, like everybody, we have the goal to release focused apps tailored to a single use case. So just nail this. So make this XKCD thing would be the case here. But then you start to explore the use case. The process is to clearly see what can the platform offers. How do we do that? Lots of spelunking. And the result is, why not do a Swiss Army knife? I mean, that's what we always do. That's what we do with this automation with AWS, which can do everything you want. And so we ended up building a cross-product app that integrates declarative chart and diagram rendering engines with Jira issues and Confluence pages. And luckily, we even won the CodeGeist second place in the Forge category, which is really great because it kind of signals that in this case, we might be right. Having a cross-product app here, it could be a good value proposition, in fact. Let's talk about this later. So what it does. So the very short version is depicted on screen. The diagram is also from the app itself. The Atlassian users can go to Jira and have a Jira issue panel. They can go to Confluence and have a Confluence macro and put in those diagrams And this is called a forge function then, which translates it into a REST API call into rendering engines, and they generate SVGs that we show in the app. Let's dive right in. I'll show you how this works in the demo. So I'm having a regular Confluence page here and have already three diagrams prepared just to make things easier a bit. And you can see already that it has various, you can do all sorts, all kinds of things like visualizations and charts and so on. And in the most easiest case, so this is just a macro that I already had, and I'll just briefly show you how this works. I think it's a bit dull. That's our standard basic starter macro, basically. So let's see what we can do to make it nicer. One idea would be to say, I'm editing the diagram. I have to know that I can have a skin param. I think param monochrome, and say, okay, maybe it looks better in monochrome than in this weird colors, and a save set. And now we have this monochrome version. Okay, but of course, if you happen to know the grammar that we use here, that's plant UML in this case, you can do more. You can do things like, I have to check my notes actually to get this right. But so this is a note right of author. So I'm now adding an additional element into the diagram based on the syntax of this particular diagram type. And you will see the effect now right here in the app. So you have seen me here editing a diagram inline. So what I mean is the diagram declaration is actually right in the macro. This works well for a simple use case like this one, but as you can imagine, a diagram like this one here is a bit more complex, even though it's based on a very smart framework, Vega. And so we have another option. You can also just reference a URL on remote, because we have the diagram specification remotely. So in this case, I use Bitbucket and snippets. And let me try to switch to another tab and edit this, or maybe I can go like here and go to this underlying snippet in Bitbucket. And you can see here that this is a JSON, which happens to be this syntax. It's still fairly straightforward, but it is can get more complex.
Sorry, one question, Stefan. Could you zoom in a bit?
Oh yeah, of course. Much, very good point. I hope that's perfect.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jörg. So you can see a couple of things here. I will already point out that the data that's shown in the map that you've seen is again referenced by URL. So we have an indirection here. The actual data that's shown is again referenced externally. But the diagram, what is done with the data, is described in this schema from Vega. And so, I can change things here. I'm not very fluent with this, but let's try something. Let's make this red. So, or even oranges. And I will now, where's the save button? Save this. So we have a new snippet version, and I go back to the Confluence. And now, because I have updated this externally, it should, in principle, be updated right here, but I have not made a mistake. So I refresh the page. There are a couple of caching issues involved, so once in a while, this doesn't work as expected, like this one. Let me try this again, please. I I can show you a new an aspect of this feature. Well, I've made a syntax error. Oh, here you can see the orange map. Please excuse the caching issue. So this would be now based on a change that I did externally to this macro, so that you can have live data. And of course, you might not want that. You might want to pin things to something. There again, we have this caching issue, so it flips back. I have referenced the version, the unversioned URL of this snippet. I can also go to the revision tab and use this particular all of the former one. As you can see here, here's the change I made from orange to blue. And if I now use Bitbucket to make this version available to me and say I want to see the raw file because I have to reference that one, I can take the URL, go back to the diagram, and now I can pin back the, so to say, if I don't want to have these automatic update effects, I could also pin a particular version. So if you follow along here, you realize that this is really just a REST URL, so you can also deploy this somewhere else, and you can automate the process of updating the data. This is getting a bit more obvious with an example like this one. So I also can also do this a bit larger, I guess. So this is a radar chart now. And once again, I have provisioned this inline. So and you can see this, the difference to this example right away is it's again with Vega is that once again, we have the data. So this is just some business that's depicted on the radar chart. But in this case, the data itself is in the diagram. So if I now make a change here and say, okay, this is just the value of 12, then you will see that this is reflected right away by pulling this orange thing in. Of course, at that level, it's getting already inconvenient. So let me show you that this is really just one of many options to deal with all this. I will try to share my Visual Studio Code editor now, and which is another way, option to edit these diagrams. So switching the app here, can you see the editor? I hope so. I just assume yes. That you interrupt
yes,
me.
Yes, it's working.
Thank you. So I now have this code that I just copied over, and they're pretty much the most of the diagram types we support have very good Visual Studio Code extensions. So you can see this is the file has a Vega file ending, and there is a Vega Visual Studio Code extension that I can open here and get a preview of this very map here right at this place. So this editor, of course, has much more versatility, better experience for users to actually deal with all these charts. So it would be much easier to make changes in this format, and you can get support to whatever the editor team of this extension comes up with. It's much simpler like this, of course. Changing values here is now pretty much instant. And like this, it's much easier to explore this with an inline preview. We would, of course, prefer to also have the preview like this in the Forge platform, but this is really something that's currently not supported. So this is how one way to do that. Another option is that pretty much all these diagrams have an online editor as well. And I can now take this and go back to my macro here and can just paste in the JSON. Everything I do by hand here is of course something that you can automate by putting this in some sort of mini app in the microservice in the backend. I will just briefly show you that this works the very same way in Jira. This is really not all that interesting at this point. In terms of different functionalities, that's a good thing about this platform. It's really kind of cross-platform. This is a Jira issue, but I need another one. Excuse me. For delay. So this is a simple diagram with AWS edit things, and you just get the very same editing dialog here, a bit embedded, but the concept is the same. So there seems to be a flaw with the content here. Let me try this to save this so that it's actually looking the same. Yeah, once in a while I have this artifact. So once again, you have this inline editor, and you can also add a title like in the other. It's really just the same experience with the same effect. The Jira version currently only supports one diagram, but we will update the data model to support more. All right, that's the basic introduction here, and I'll stop the share and go back to, no, I need to continue the share actually. I need to go back to my presentation, I'm sorry. So that's where we are. And so let's talk a bit about what have we seen here. First and foremost, we have seen diagram as code. We have seen the app. We have used Amazon Web Services in the back, and finally the Forge platform. Diagrams as code. What does it mean? Basically, you've seen just that, and it means that you can describe something and manage it in the same way you would develop software. There's a big trend these days to have everything as code. The most prominent examples are infrastructure as code, where you can deploy all these services in AWS and Microsoft Azure and so on, with services like CloudFormation, Terraform. You have configuration as code. Atlassian uses this as well. For example, the Bitbucket pipelines, the description of how your build is configured is a YAML file. The Bamboo specs is another version. You can do everything as code. Workflows would be an option. I know that Jörg is very interested in docs as code, and there's doc toolchain and write the docs as two examples. We would also very much prefer to have our own app documentation in Confluence, in code. But on the other hand, we are an app vendor, so we only use Confluence, and this is a bit of a schisma that we haven't really figured out yet how to have the best of both worlds. And maybe this approach might provide some options down the road, because just like we now have provided diagrams as code, we could also think about embedding these docs as code right in Confluence. The benefits are pretty well known to everyone attending, I guess. It's machine readable, so that means you can versionize it, as I have shown you with the Bitbucket snippets. You can audit this. You always know who changed when what on the diagram, in our case, what happened. You can roll back. And for me, the most interesting aspect is actually automation. So you could you can automate creating the data that is fed into a diagram, what you actually see, and tie it to your business logic. Like if you have a new sale, a new customer, or a new support request, you can update the respective charts from your business logic right in the backend with this automated approach. It's worth noting that there are two variations of configurations code. Most of them are declarative, and I've only shown you these, but there you can also have them imperative, like more like software is usually written. And this has benefits and drawbacks that we might touch upon in a moment. This is our app. So how does it work? A user calls into Jira or Confluence. In Jira, you have seen this issue panel, in Confluence a macro currently. We can do other things maybe. This calls a forge function, which translates a diagram definition into the respective API calls. This goes out to an API gateway in AWS, which acts as a router and selects the appropriate diagram rendering engine. So each engine, each different diagram type has a different diagram engine. Basically, I walked you through this right now. The interesting aspect is that the front end is serverless in Forge. The core business logic, so the Glue code, is also serverless in Forge. The back end is once again serverless. The engines are completely serverless in AWS, so we don't have much operational overhead here. And what we don't have yet is a concept of data sources. the running engines is kind of like a service provider interface, an SPI. So I've seen you shown you a couple of those that we have included here. And we could also do other ones. For example, there are a couple of completely different things that you can do. I'm not sure whether this actually is, it's still on screen. Nice, it's local storage. This is called Excalidra, and you can do nice handwritten things. It's a great tool, and could of course build now, could build a running engine that takes the format of this software and makes it available to Confluence users and Jira users. And another interesting variation would be Wardlay maps. It's something that probably not so many people know. It's a business process modeling tool in a way. And it looks like this. What I'm just trying to show you here is once again a very simple domain-specific language. And we get a domain-specific diagram that depicts this concept. And once again, we can just make edits here. As usual, I have to know that this also has a handwritten mode, which I like. And so now the diagram changed. It would be fairly straightforward for us to write a new engine for this particular diagram format. And I talked about charts accessibility already. This is on a backlog. It's a bit more difficult on the technical side. I'll spare you the details. Another interesting example is diagrams. So what's specific about this is that this is not declarative, but it's imperative. So this time you actually have Python code. It's just regular Python programming code. I'll make it a bit bigger. So those of you who have already developed something in Python will recognize this. And the imperative style has the benefits that you can do loops and stuff much simpler. So you can reap some benefits from imperative programming to generate diagrams more automatically. You have more scale in this. The downside is, and we also need to consider this before we support something like this, is that imperative code is much more prone to security issues. So you need to sandbox it properly. So this is something that we can probably guarantee on AWS Lambda, but this is something we really just will postpone for a bit because it's not such a problem to solve right now. But they support all sorts of diagrams. This is Kubernetes stuff and all the other clouds here, as well Azure and so on. So that would once again unlock a lot of potential for the user. The part we haven't solved yet, or we actually haven't even tackled yet, is data sources. So far, the data sources are part of the diagram, as I've shown you. You can either have them right in the diagram, the data points, or in the case of the Vega map of the United States, you can have it as a reference from the declarative data description. However, in this case of a Jira and Confluence app, it might be interesting to do something else and to also allow the user to make SQL queries in Confluence and provide a table with a query right from your product or in Jira as well. You can make a Jira query language query to get some issues and have it as a data table. And then you could use the very same rendering engines that we offer here, but inject these data from the host product to render diagrams right in Confluence and Jira. There are obviously many apps in the marketplace that do that quite well. So we need to figure out whether it makes sense to have an option for this, whether we can maybe provide more versatility here with different diagram styles or have other value propositions that would be interesting for the users. I would, in both cases, be interested to hear later what you might expect from something like this, which kind of diagrams you want to see and which data sources you would consider. I will just very briefly mention how we do the Amazon style. This is all serverless. That's the good stuff. Basically, we start with the Atlassian Forge function to the left. So that runs in Forge. Still, it's a Lambda function, as we know. This calls out into a very new service from AWS. It's called Global Accelerator. It's not really that important here, but it just makes things much faster and it's easy to plug in. Basically, it reroutes traffic from the internet onto the AWS backbone worldwide. And so we can spare quite some milliseconds in traffic. So if Confluence instance runs in the United States, and our service would run in Europe currently, then this saves quite some time. We have a load balancer. The load balancer is in the middle, and it is protected with a web application firewall and SSL certificate from RCM, from the certificate manager. And the load balancer routes the traffic to the running API. I talked already about it, and then that routes it to the respective rendering engines, either in Docker or in Lambda functions. Ideally, we would just use Lambda function because they can run for 15 minutes. It should be more than enough for every diagram. But a couple of them are just easier to implement right now in Docker, and this would be an optimization for us to make it a call-by-call thing. I just talked about this. I might mention that we deploy the whole infrastructure also as configuration as code. So once again, in this case, infrastructure as code, we use AWS CloudFormation, which is a declarative language in YAML or JSON that describes your AWS infrastructure, and you can just reap all the benefits we talked about already. Notably, everything is serverless, and if you are interested in exploring in tagging something to your and using your Forge apps to call out to AWS and implement some backend code yourself that you cannot do in Forge right now, maybe, then I recommend you to look into the serverless tooling. We'll use the AWS SAM CLI and AWS Amplify to implement small micro apps, so to say. And you can then share them with your colleagues or even with the general public with these techniques I have here. Finally, let's talk a bit more about Forge as a platform, because that's certainly interesting for everyone, for us as a marketplace partner for commercial apps, but also for every enthusiast and for every technical user in enterprises. The platform has already been introduced in the previous talks a couple of weeks ago. And this is basically what Arnel showed there. You have a user interface and event sources in Jira and Confluence. And you have the business logic in a Forge function. And from there, you can call your own custom APIs or third-party services if you need to. You can also stop right at the Forge app business logic in the middle if everything you need can be done in 10 seconds time, which is the time the function can run right in Forge. The whole developer experience is driven by a CLI. The dev cycle is very convenient and well known. It uses basically what web technologies use. It's very similar to React and JavaScript, TypeScript ecosystem. So user interface declarative. It's similar to React and JSX, but not quite the same. So be aware that you have to learn a bit something new. The code is serverless, and optionally you have these backends. If you want to learn more about this, I recommend the talk from Arnil that was a couple of weeks ago here in the Atlassian Community Berlin Brandenburg. More importantly for us here is a couple of challenges and opportunities with the platform. So how do we currently judge this as a marketplace partner who wants to start over with developing cloud ops based on this platform? First and foremost, the roadmap is very ambitious. So Atlassian is all in on this. They invest a lot of time and staff into this. They are 100% committed to make this work. But this also means many of the things that they want to do and need to cover to make it a viable platform for commercial apps might not be in place yet. And we will have to see whether this is going to be production ready in a timely manner. And as usually with anything new, you have adoption risks. Because maybe some things do not work quite well initially and need to figure out over time. The declarative user interface has limits because notably currently you don't have any HTML, CSS or JavaScript based styling. So you are at the peril of what the Atlassian team makes available that makes the app look very nice and consistent. But it's not possible to do many fancy things. As you might have seen when I did the demo, I didn't have a syntax editor for JSON there because we cannot do anything about it right there. And so on. For complex and long-running business logic, you need an external API like we did here for this diagram rendering. The diagram rendering engines are just too complex this is not something that you can do in this 10 seconds limit right within the app, mostly because the runtime is restricted and we cannot pull in all the dependencies we need, but also because the Lambda Pure for us or Docker in AWS is just much more performant. We can use much more performant versions there than Atlassian offers us here. Also, the function as a service is not equal to the DOM. That's just a warning for those that are versed in web technologies. So you need to adapt to a slightly different app pattern. It's more like a page cycle, like we did develop web apps like 10 years ago. Currently, you cannot even distribute Forge apps. That's a bummer. So I cannot make this app available to you other than sharing the source code, which is of course fine for in-house teams, but it's not something that it's a good option for the general public. Furthermore, there's no marketplace for Forge apps, so I cannot sell apps based on this, which would be an incentive for many to really drive this forward. And finally, there is not yet a concept to have a hybrid apps between the old and the new platform, Connect and Forge, which makes it a challenge for the established vendors to maybe adopt the platform, which could hinder adoption a bit, and also makes it difficult to compensate for limits that Forge apps currently had for things that are not supported in Forge. Now, you see all these, the footnote starts there, and they all go to the very same footnote, and I will plug this right here. In next week, on the November 10th, Atlassian has a big event. November 9th is a team tour event. That's more the user-oriented presentation of current state of affairs. I guess I'll talk a lot of about server end of life and cloud and so on. And on November 10th, there's Developer Day. And everyone who is interested in Forge, I highly recommend you to register and go there, because this is supposedly all about Forge. And they hinted on quite some announcement in the realms of the challenges that I just mentioned. So I would hope that they might actually address a couple of these issues next week, maybe even have a GA date for the Forge platform. It's kind of announced for the fourth quarter now. So maybe next week we can see this going live. And I would hope that they solve one or the other of these challenges for us right now. The marketplace, however, is pretty sure that will last until next spring at the least. Still, there are a lot of opportunities with Forge. We really enjoyed working with this, I have to say. It's rapid prototyping, has an excellent developer experience. It's everybody who's working with current technologies in the JavaScript world is right at home. The CLI is already in a good state. It's very convenient. It just was plain fun. The declarative UI also has benefits. You may wonder, I just listed it as a challenge, but for me, I'm not a front-end developer. It's actually beneficial because I'm not really good in CSS, JS stuff these days. So I don't want to be bothered with this. And I'm quite happy if the platform vendor pulls most of the bells and whistles for me. And I have to cope with a couple of limits then. But for me, at this point in time, it's actually a benefit. I don't have to bother about user interface. Atlassian will automatically make it better over time. One day, they will have a syntax editor for JSON, and I will just put a simple tag in my component declaration, and then I'll have this fully managed by Atlassian. That's just great. It's already great for lightweight custom solutions. I mentioned the app Meet with Jitsi that we are using on a daily basis, basically to organize our team meetings. And everyone today can use this for in-house tools to quickly cobble something up in Jira and Confluence Cloud. It's also a good option for solution partners, actually, because this is a very lightweight way to solve customer problems, at least in the prototyping way, but maybe even for production. I recommend to look into this. A very special aspect is that you can do cross-product apps, as I showed you a bit. Atlassian promises to really pay attention to developing a consistent platform this time around. They never did this in the past. I'm a bit skeptical because Confluence and Jira are really just too different, but at least from a developer point of view, you have the same API patterns in place, and this makes it easy to work with this. And in this case of our app, it's literally the same function that serves Jira and Confluence. Of course, we have different front-end components. We have a macro in Confluence and a issue panel in Jira, but the actual business logic is one function for both. That's pretty great. You have much deeper integration options than with Connect. So because the code runs now and runs co-located with the Atlassian tools right in AWS data center, right besides Jira and Confluence, you have milliseconds time between the integrations in Forge and the Atlassian host products. And you can do completely new things that weren't possibly based on this webhook and REST API concept. For example, Forge already has a Jira workflow validator where you can prevent a transition of Jira issue to move forward. And this is, of course, a decision that has to be done in milliseconds time so that you wouldn't block a workflow, for example, with a batch issue edit or something. And this was something that didn't offer for Connect, at least not for a long time, because it was just not doable across the internet, basically. Super important for us as a vendor and for everyone involved is less operation overhead. We don't have to run this. We only have to run our own API if we need one. In this case, we need one. But allow me to say, this is a much constrained surface area for us as a vendor. We still have a software as a service, so to say, these diagram rendering engines. But we don't have to care about managing the users. All the user data is managed by Atlassian. We have these GDPR problems are much more constrained. And we have much better security boundaries all around. Data ownership and residency is at least controlled by Atlassian. Not everything is in place yet. For example, right now I can actually just send these diagrams from Confluence to our backend in AWS without anybody agreeing to this upfront, but Atlassian has a fixed roadmap item that I expect them to solve soon that's called data egress handling, which means if you install our app, the administrator would actually need to allow this particular URL that we offer to make these diagrams happen so that nobody else could do something with it and you have full control over. You can at least know exactly who is using the data and what kind of data. Alongside this comes much more granular permissions when you install an app, so you can be clear with the security boundaries. It's really a significant improvement over the Connect apps. All right. As a summary, visualizing this code really worked well for us. I'm quite happy about this, and we will use this for ourselves. We are in the process of building our new business processes for the marketplace, and we will use this app to actually make our daily business metrics visible to us in our own marketplace partner Jira and Confluence instances. This is just something I'm looking forward to. Forge is a rapid prototyping platform already. I highly recommend playing around with this if you're interested in coding. It absolutely enables every technical team member to start with programming. This whole serverless developer experience enables what nowadays is called a citizen developer. So as you know, software developers are in huge demand. There are just not enough people who go through the formal education, but the productivity increases in the whole space are significant and you can do much more with much less code. And so everybody can try to make small apps possible with serverless technologies, and Atlassian has now made this available to every Atlassian user as well. So if your team has some needs and you are into a tiny bit of coding, I highly recommend to try this. The big question is, will this be ready for prime time in 2021? So will we actually see apps in the marketplace, which would also provide momentum to move this forward? I already showed you the footnote. Next week is Partner Day, Developer Day at the Atlassian Team Tour, and I hope we can see a couple of important announcements in this direction. With that, may the Forge be with you, I would say. And let's talk about what you heard. Happy to take any questions. I know I talked too fast, so please just get back to everything that has been unclear.
The first question is, can you customize the macro to include switches? Like you showed the switch from blue to orange, so that I have a toggle in the macro where I just say blue, orange, and then switch from one to the other.
That's an excellent question. I actually, I have to admit, I just forgot to make a bullet point for this aspect on our app. So what you're, in the more general way, what you're asking about is, can I interact with the diagrams? Can I do things like make controls available to the user who switch all kinds of things around? And the answer is twofold. First, quite some of these diagram engines, for example, Vega, have these concepts included in the language. So you can actually do that in the diagram language. However, this requires JavaScript. And at this point of time, these diagrams are converted into a scalable vector graphic image from our backend. And it's, and this would also still support this. But the Atlassian platform is geared towards security. So that strips this JavaScript functionality from these images that these are. So at this point, this doesn't work. So we need to figure out a way to make controls available to the user on the outside of the diagram. So to connect controls like you asked for, switch the color or reference a different data source, for example, is something that I hinted on from Forge. And to be honest, we haven't really explored this yet, but we definitely would need to do this to make it a viable product for users, I think.
Okay, next question. And you kind of answered that during your presentation, but just to repeat it, does Vega allow the usage of external data sources, or does everything need to be hard-coded?
It uses external data sources. So Vega is one of those that have this concept built in. So you have the option to either embed the data into the diagram declaration, or you can reference the URL externally. And quite some others have this as well. Some have not. And what we will do definitely, I have this, I had this one slide. This is the first obvious thing where we want to give the user the control to kind of inject the data into the diagram. So in the Forge app front end, we would have a data source concept. And I see that Sven is on the call as well. Hi, Sven. So Lively Apps has a great app that it's called Pocket Query, and I really like it. Which allows you to make fancy queries into Confluence. And it would be great to make this data that comes from Pocket Query available to this visualization, for example. So we have something to talk about whether we can collaborate on this in one way or the other. So definitely the data source should be injectable from the user into the diagrams. Basically you would get a kind of a variable reference at the very point where in this example that I showed you, there was a URL.
And we also have a recording from Sven where he talks about building a data integration for him a while back for Confluence with their apps. Can reference that as well, because there the whole Pocket Query thing and everything was also explained. So that's in our library. Another question, do you see the changes in Jira and the issue history?
To be frank, I do not really know, but I prepared this demo a couple of hours ago. I was a bit late with some things, or put another way, they took longer than expected. So I just had to do some changes today. And I actually stumbled over something that I wasn't aware of. So I tried to clone the Jira issue that I have a whole set of issues there for demo purposes. And I wanted to clone the story with the subtasks, with all the subtasks with the various diagram types to show you this in more detail. But then I noticed that lo and behold, when I clone an issue, the diagram is not copied. So from that, I would deduce that the answer to your question is no, because I'm afraid that Atlassian hasn't yet tied the data. We use the hosted storage from the host to store the diagram, but the diagram needs to be correlated to the issue, of course. And this is not provided by the platform, so we would need to build this into the app itself. So we need to references, and it's not something we even looked at it yet. This was a hackathon, so this is basically a flaw that I realized this afternoon, and your question is totally spot on. That this is something you want to have. You want to tie this to the issue for sure.
So stuff to do. I have one more question. I see we have one more participant. Let me just. Okay. I have one more question. Does Forge allow a mechanism to capture exceptions? So if I have something that runs longer than 10 seconds and doesn't deliver a result, can I capture that exception and create a proper error message? So for example, please try again.
Or yes, whatever. This is possible. There are two. This is all not really fully fleshed out yet, I think. Yeah. But this is basically you have two scenarios. You have exceptions if you don't catch them. If the Forge platform already shows a kind of a error panel, the regular one with a red exclamation mark, and gives you some details from the errors, usually very technical. But at least you get a feedback that something went wrong, kind of. And we can catch these exceptions in the app and can convert them into something nice. For example, show an issue panel that really guides the user to what you need to do eventually to solve this. Yeah.
Cool. So maybe I have also a question, more like technical question. So you showed, for example, that in the macro and Confluence, the syntax that has to be used for generating the picture, right? And could you tell us more about that syntax that is used, or who maintained it and who especially improved it, or like giving more options to be used there? Is it an open source, or is some coin that it belongs to your company, or maybe other developers can also do some development if needed on that particular syntax?
Yeah, good question. This, I should have made this more obvious then. Try to go back here to the demo page where I have this linked. So we have a page where we link all the diagram types that we currently support. This is a table with what we have. I showed you this Vega and Vega Lite. And these are both, can you see my screen? Yes. Each and every diagram we use is open source. So answer this upfront. So these are all very most of them are very well maintained open source communities with a whole large community, and they develop this, they improve this all the time. For example, just to give you an idea, this is an example gallery from Vega. You have these regular charts and all kinds of stuff that you can do here. So lots of options there, and the same goes for all the others. I showed you the syntax from PlantUML. This is a bit more, let's say, old-fashioned, I think. We had these things, but they also have a couple of modes. I'm not sure whether they're on this page, but you've seen these AWS diagrams that we have, and there's a kind of a variation on this with a different theme, so to say. And here's, for example, for the Google Cloud. This is on this, based on the same platform, looks completely different, right? And we have Mehmet. Mehmet is pretty popular, I think, in the community. It has once again another syntax and another style. So the diagrams are much simpler. This is too small, makes this bigger. And but it's not it's not unlike the one I showed you, right? So, but it's a different project with different options, and you can work with the community to expand the feature set, and usually can get themings and more examples there. And pretty much all of them have the two important things. They have an online playground where you can explore these grammars in an online editor with JavaScript, and most of them actually have a Visual Studio Code extension. I showed you the one for PlantUML. And this makes it possible to just develop your code locally and commit it to source control and move on from there. What else do we support? We support Graphits. This is very old, but for some things it's helpful. C4 is once again a plant UML dialect. And its theory is that's limitless. So whenever we find a new diagram that would have demands from users, so I would be interested to hear what you would like to see, we can talk about, is this something that we can make happen? Because the AWS platform makes it fairly straightforward for us to plug in such a new engine into the backend and just let you enter the code in the front end. We don't need to deal with the code ourselves.
So you actually have a replacement for Structurizer in Confluence.
If you will. I mean, as I said, there are a lot of good apps that, and there's a lot, as we discover while we talk here, to make it an app a commercially viable product, there's a lot more to it. So this is really fun to explore for us, and I'm sure we will use it, but it's not yet decided if and when, which part of that we might be want to make available. I would be very interested in this, and maybe we can provide a lightweight version that's quick and easy for small stuff. Right now, we wouldn't have these front-end controls, for example. This is something that would be a lot of work for us to do.
No, but there are a lot of tools out there who basically, the good thing that I see here is that, that Confluence can gain ground back in areas where it lost ground, like, for example, in the whole domain-driven design community, where you have this, for example, domain storytelling. I don't know if you know that, WPS, they have a JavaScript API where you can have a domain, and you mentioned Wortley mapping.
Yeah.
I happen to have a Wortley mapping bootcamp on Friday with Simon himself.
Oh, wow, great. So
I will mention that, that you're working on that. But there's a lot of stuff that you can do that makes development. And we had actually, Laurent Pai from SmartBear here, who, and they are looking at something that helps them do the example mapping right in Cucumber for Jira. And they are doing that with Miro until now, but are looking into something they can do themselves. And that is also, if you have something like Cucumber in Jira or something like that, having the example map for the Jira, with the Jira issue, also code generated, not only the Cucumber code, that would be, that is a big step forward. That's you can do very cool stuff for collaborative modeling and the whole development workflow. As you said, to get all these developer citizens back. So that have kind of left Atlassian in the last couple of years.
Right. You can really do very, you can Google short-term changes for the demonstration. It's actually a good example. Yeah. If you do have a presentation, I can do a change really last minute because it's versionized and can push it. I can do it inline quickly and can change the presentation right up front because I don't have to deal with a complex diagramming tool. It's really just kind of promising for stuff like this. That's right. Yeah. Would you also want to actually do what Pocket Query does? So query the host products, or is this something that you do? Are you looking more on these external things, external data sources? Do you think we have different audiences for these things? So Pocket Query has a very specific audience which enjoys this really nicely done app. To make these SQL queries and show data, basically just the typical charts you need for business logic, right?
I must admit, I'm not 100% sure. We're also asking ourselves this question in general about going to cloud. So we don't even know yet. I'm actually working on Pocket Query right now as we're talking for a cloud, but we don't even know yet if it really makes sense in the cloud. It's really hard to answer. We're still researching that, but I guess in the end, if there is a set of customers who's interested in this, I think that it's pretty much the same set of customers. Yes, I think if there's someone interested in your app, they probably are interested in Pocket Query as well, and the other way around. Yeah.
So we should talk about this some more because, as I said, we don't have data sources right now. And if I could just use your data sources because you have this concept in your app, then it would be much more reliable and readily available right now.
Yeah.
Of course.
For sure. There's also the question whether that is technical technically feasible currently, but we would probably find a way to do it. Yeah.
But the 10 second limit, I mean, forces you anyway to outsource a lot. So yeah. You have to find a way in Forge to trigger some bigger query task in the backend, and then come back, 20 seconds, a minute later, and pick up the results. So yeah. That you have kind of an asynchronous query process. So basically the first call triggers the backend, and then the second call goes into a repository and looks up the result, for example, and then renders it or whatever. So something like that.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I can add two observations to this. First, of course, this runs on AWS Lambda, the Forge platform, and Atlassian has just deliberately shortened this, cut this off after 10 seconds for various reasons. Then just need to figure out how this works. Mm-hmm. But Lambda itself runs for 15 minutes even, if you want to. So they could make this available for developers. Maybe they need to figure out a pricing model to say, okay, if you have more resources, you actually need to pay for this something. Or this is not really clear. This is exploring this themselves. Mm-hmm. The other thing is, I peeked into the source code the other day from one of the NPM modules they released. And there was a hint of something new that's coming. And this is exactly what you mentioned. They will introduce a concept of asynchronous background function, sort of, I think. Or at least background functions, so functions that you can call from the other functions. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't clear how this will work. We'll need to figure that out. And finally, maybe there are, of course, a lot of other serverless platforms springing, coming to life currently. Many people know NetLify, I think, for example, or the Cloudflare Workers. So other platforms for web apps also introduce these things. And I think it was NetLify or Fastly. No, NetLify, I think, it's just actually done this very thing. They have, so far, they had a 10 seconds limit. And just this week, they announced that they will have now have you can have functions that run for up to 15 minutes. So they open the whole thing. Okay. And this has a different pricing model attached indeed.
Okay. But if you have something that runs for 15 minutes, you have a money issue as well. So yes. Because that's if it runs that long, you have a very comfortable bank account in the background. Yep. So, but that's also there's some discussion going on in the community Slack channel and everything, and in the community groups as well about the similar topic is automations in Jira right now in cloud, because there's a limit how many you can do a month and everything, and how much processing power you can use within your license.
Yep.
And I guess that's I can imagine that is very tricky for Atlassian to figure out. Because that can become very expensive. If you say I have unlimited function calls with 10 seconds each and AWS is billing you for that, that is can be very tricky, very expensive.
Absolutely. This is mm-hmm. one of the things my talk was too long anyway, I realized. So I didn't want to dive even more into this, but it's kind of interesting that this is one of the challenges that the Connect platform has, for example. So everybody has to run a software as a service business, and the Atlassian apps, as you know, are priced per user. And this is the only pricing dimension we have. And this means you have to account for this. You have to throttle them at some point. If you have an expensive business process like exporting PDFs, for example, yeah. you have to do the math. You have to know how many PDFs my 1,000 user Jira license will possibly export per month, because it needs to be covered by this per user count. And if they happen to do more, you make a loss. And this is really, it's not trivial. I really hope we have, this is a longstanding demand also from the ecosystem to Atlassian to offer a different pricing model maybe, and say, okay, this is something they could maybe do with the Forge platform, because it's more accessible for them from a platform perspective, to say, we offer this resource-based pricing. You can have background functions, as you alluded to, mm-hmm. and users can buy packages of those, or can just get a credit card in and say, each month afterwards, we get the bill and pay with what we actually used. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, I'm not really sure how that is. I haven't figured it out. So AWS, the big cloud providers, they all do resource-based pricing, really just per second, per gigabyte, per something. And this also makes sure that the pricing is really low and just gets lower typically. And over the couple of years, I the last years, I noticed that while many startups started their own pricing models also around this concept, most of them, almost all of them, ended up with user-based pricing. So they went away from actual resource-based pricing and utility-based pricing. And this is something I don't understand. One possible explanation is that it's easier to reason about for your finance department. You book it upfront and you know what you pay, and there's no variability involved, no risk involved, nothing.
Yeah, because user, if you calculate the price per user right, you get a lot of overbooking. So you have 1,000 users and 10 users are using functions. So 900 users are for free, basically. So pure profit. If you do that right, that's very profitable. And the other question that I have is, the topic gets a lot more complex, of course, if you introduce something like a marketplace for Forge apps. So if it's not only the core products that create load, but also add-ons. And how do you divide the AWS backend bill if also the add-on is running in your tenant or whatever?
Yes, but there I have some insight due to our AWS expertise, and I can say that this is really an area where Atlassian has a lot of opportunities. AWS provides the necessary controls to make this, to separate these things. And it starts even by on the account level. It's very common these days that companies have dozens of AWS accounts, and Atlassian certainly runs the apps in a completely different account than the Jira and Confluence. So they run in the same region probably. So say for the Jira and Confluence instance that run in Ireland currently in Europe, the apps that we have here probably run in Ireland as well. So you get this millisecond connection times between the two, but it's almost certain. I mean, I don't know it, but it's one for me. It's obvious that this is a different AWS account, completely different security controls, and they have complete insight into which function calls what. So you have it per function. So they know that this function that we use for rendering, they can have a line item in the invoice for this. So they have the opportunity in theory to go very granular with this and can sum up every vendor, every user, every tenant. How far, of course, you have to decide what you want. No?
Yeah. But that makes also sense, what you mentioned with sandboxing this and everything.
Yeah.
So to have that separately. One question regarding your workflow, is there any way to load test Forge apps, or how do you do that? I mean, functional tests, that's just push a button, see if it works. But load testing, something like that? Or is there anything possible in that area right now?
It's a good question. Why
would you want to do that? Like, that's kind of the equivalent to load testing a Lambda function, really, right? You mean for testing the underlying infrastructure, or what would you want to achieve when load testing?
I just wanted to run a number of tests and see what happens in Lambda, for example, because you can, of course, you don't have to load test Lambda because Lambda does what it does. But the problem is, if you do not load test your Lambda applications properly, that can cost you a lot of money.
Yeah.
Because if you underestimate how much computing resources and everything are consumed by your function, that can be a very bad day at the accounting department at the end of the month.
Yeah.
So load. You are right. You do not have a question with. You do not have a problem with resources, but your load testing is now money. So you have money-driven development. You have to load test for
absolutely
money consumptions. So MDD basically.
That will be a subject of the Wardley camp, I guess, because that's something he's very interested in, the making, they call it, just escaped me, but attaching a monetary value to every business transaction you have in detail end to end. And this is also how I would approach this. Once again, AWS has all these controls in place. So there's a complete tracing infrastructure, and what we would need to do to get this insight is basically we could in the JavaScript code in the Lambda function that runs in Forge, we would see the trace identifier per function invocation. And we can also, and this gets passed on to our backend via the REST API then. So we can kind of make an educated guess, or we can actually get some metrics about how long does Lambda function run in Atlassian, and then in our backend, and we could try to say, okay, our backend, we can try to make our backend quicker if that's a problem, or we can we need to do something else if we reach the 10 seconds limit. So you have some options, but it's not explored yet, I have to admit.
Yeah, but especially with your architecture where you call a rendering engine in AWS, which is an external resource, which generates additional costs, which are somewhere else, I guess. So,
right, but we have, this is our AWS account. So
yeah, of course.
From this boundary on, we have very good insight on what happens. We can do exactly that, what I just mentioned. We also can do this line item and say, each call per tenant has this and this cost attached.
And as long as Atlassian doesn't charge you for the cost, forge is not a problem. So that's not an issue. Yeah.
Might happen one day, but not right now.
Yeah. Okay. So, but that's why I'm asking if there's a workflow already in place to test that.
Not yet.
Information. No. Okay.
So once I have a roadmap item for better developer and kind of better operations tooling in general, and I expect this to be surfaced kind of in the marketplace app portal. So if you distribute an app to your user, you have a place where they can show metrics like this. And they have already talked about in the presentation at Forge and Atlas Camp what they consider there, but I think it's a low priority item currently. So it's just not the right thing.
And if you haven't done so, register for Developer Day next week.
Absolutely.
That will probably give a lot of answers what will happen. And from the event that we are planning next week, this event. It would have been nice to have all that in place before they killed the server. That would have been fun. So that was unfortunate. Forge out of beta would be a big step to calm all those server nerves. So that would be...
It's a timing that's hard to follow on, but I guess it's just dynamics in place that do not necessarily correlate.
So my fingers are crossed that next week Forge comes out of beta.
I would actually expect so.
Yeah, and that would be a good thing.
The more detailed question for me is how much new stuff do they attach to this? Because, I mean, to be fair, it's kind of stable. So we haven't had many glitches or something. So it's, and Atlassian uses is themselves. I didn't mention that specifically enough, I'm afraid. This is very good. Atlassian will develop their own many modules, many features of Jira and Confluence within this platform because it's very good for themselves. And this is a major difference to the Connect framework where they just didn't do that. So basically the vendors have all the pain because they use platform and Atlassian breaks it because they do shortcuts and don't consider the ecosystem. And this will hopefully change. I mean, fingers crossed, you never know. They might still take shortcuts, but they have a very good incentive to really do that this time around because there's no pain attached to the contrary. The Forge platform is so good that it's beneficial for their own teams. Okay. And so it would be helpful to use this and to eat their own dog food. And this will benefit all of us, the app vendors, Atlassian, and also each and everyone who uses Atlassian tools and wants to solve his own problem, her own problem with a quick app.
Yeah, from your mouth to God's ear and hopefully Atlassian's ear. So Atlassian, if you are listening, listen to Steffen. Do it right. So that's
the... Yeah, please, okay. please.
Okay. That's it for tonight. Thank you again, Steffen. That was most educational.
Thanks for having me.
We learned a lot. And looking forward to seeing you somewhere in the real soon. Come back if you have other ideas. We are always here. We are here every Monday. So, and next year is 51 Mondays. So one of them can be yours if you have another idea, and we would be happy to have you back.
Thank you. Duly noted, and thanks for having me.
Thank you. Have a good night. Have a good time, and see you around. Stay healthy out there, and stay safe, and the best of times.